Let everybody get seated. Good morning, I'm Representative Anita Kulik. I'd like to call this meeting of the House Game and Fisheries Committee to order. The purpose of this meeting is to accept the report of the Game Commission. We'll be hearing from Mr. Burhan today and anyone else. Again, you know, we spoke before, anyone else you would need to reference. I'd ask the members to please hold any questions until all testifiers have given their testimony. If you are remote, and welcome everyone who is remote, I'd ask that you please stay muted. If you need to ask a question, you can do it through chat. Correct? Okay. This is a required yearly meeting. The annual report was timely filed, and we're happy to be here today to hear testimony on what's going on with the Game Commission this past year. And if there's things coming up for the coming year, we'd like to hear that also. I will hand it over now to Representative Maloney.
Thank you, and good morning. Thank you, Chairwoman. I think you're probably going to do introductions, so I won't take that, but just want to welcome everybody and know that this is very important to the sportsmen in Pennsylvania. And as I often say, they are the reason we're here. So thank you, and we'll follow up.
And we'll do a roll call first.
Chairwoman Kulik? Chair.
Okay, thank you. And I'm going to let everyone here on the panel introduce themselves. We'll start down with Representative Mahaffey and just work our way down the table.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Representative State, yeah, great day. Sorry about that. Tom Mahaffey, State Representative, the 106th District, Dauphin County.
State Representative Shelby Labs, I represent the 143rd District in Bucks County.
Representative Jake from the Lake Erie, Bana, representative of the 4th District. Nice to meet you.
Representative Joe Adams, 139th District, Wayne and Pike Counties, Northeastern PA.
Representative Chris Pielli, the 156th in Chester County.
Joe Cerisi, the 146th, Montgomery County. I'm looking forward to being educated on game and fishery. I am an open book on this because I've never fished and never hunted. So come to my office and teach me.
Welcome to PA.
All right, Maloney.
For some reason, we're not getting the meeting period online.
Representative McNeil, was that you? Can you state that again? Okay, and while we're waiting, Representative Gurgley?
Yes, Matt Gurgley, represent much of the Mon Valley in Allegheny County, 35th District. I'm new here and very much interested in both game and fisheries, hunting and fishing. So thank you for having me. Excited to be here.
Okay, so we'll get started. Mr. Burhan.
A brighter green. It is my pleasure to appear before you today representing the Pennsylvania Game Commission, your state wildlife agency. If I could, I'd like to take a few moments and recognize some individuals that are here with me today. We'll start with our commissioners. We have Commissioners Kinnick, if they could raise their hand or stand up. Kinnick, Commissioner Schwalm, and Commissioner DeMarco. And with our staff here today, we have Bureau Directors Dave Gustafson, Stephen Smith, Matt Moret, Dan Dudlap, Dr. Matthew Schnoop, Jason Dukoski, Dr. Jagnow, and some guy named Josh Zimmerman. Also, we have our Deputy Executive Director, Dave Mitchell, and I'd also like to introduce you to the next Deputy Executive Director who will start this Saturday, Deanna Vance. I am proud of the work done over the past year by our employees, volunteers, and board members. Collectively, we represent a team of individuals dedicated to fulfilling the agency's mission and managing and protecting wildlife and their habitats while promoting hunting and trapping for current and future generations. The Game Commission is responsible for managing 480 species that can be found across the state, 414 species of wild birds, and 66 species of wild mammals. An essential component of managing these species is performing research to monitor population levels, conduct disease surveillance, and obtain the most up-to-date information on Pennsylvania's wildlife. This research then guides management decisions that are necessary to produce healthy wildlife populations. As everyone on this committee is well aware, the deer hunting traditions within our state are unmatched. Deer season in Pennsylvania is one of the most highly participated forms of outdoor recreation anywhere in the country. And monitoring the harvest from those seasons is a critical part of our deer management program. Last year, more than 75 trained employees visited over 400 deer processors, collecting data on more than 20,000 harvested deer. This research plays a key role in the management recommendation for this year's deer season. In addition, last year represented the 10th year of a long-term research project done in cooperation with the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources and Penn State University, studying the impact of deer and forest habitat. The slow growth of vegetation necessitates a long study period for a project such as this. But the questions it seeks to answer are of monumental importance for the future of Penn's woods, and we continue to learn of the impact and the role that deer play in forest regeneration. Last year marked the first year of a four-year research project on wild turkey populations. This is a cooperative effort with researchers from Penn State University and the Wildlife Futures Program at the University of Pennsylvania. Which will study turkey hen movement, survival, nesting, and disease prevalence. Last year, field crews in four wildlife management units, 2D, 3D, 4D, and 5C, trapped 106 female turkeys during the winter of 2022 and attached transmitters on each. The transmitters record each hen's GPS location and activity multiple times a day. This new technology is allowing the agency to monitor not only specific habitat a hen is using, but also what she is doing throughout the day. Each year of the study, an additional 100 transmitters will be deployed, making it the largest study of wild turkeys ever conducted in our state. In 2023, the state wildlife agencies of New Jersey, Maryland, and Ohio will be joining this project as well to provide a regional perspective. Last year also marked the beginning of a new research project on our state bird, the ruffed grouse. We have started a research project to study grouse genetic diversity across the state. This project will be done using wings that were sent to us by hunters within the past decade, as well as recent tissue samples from different regions. Working with Penn State University, we'll analyze the results to determine if there is genetically distinct populations of grouse. This will help determine where grouse may be at the greatest risk of disappearing due to low genetic diversity or lack of connectivity to other grouse populations. We will then be able to identify where habitat creation and improvement is needed the most to increase connectivity and genetic diversity to promote long-term population growth. We have also joined a research project with 22 other states to study the recent population decline in eastern mallards. This project aims to learn more about habitat use, breeding success, and how behavior throughout the year can affect survival and breeding success. In the winter of 2021, 49 transmitters were deployed. In the first breeding season following deployment, Pennsylvania captured mallards remained in the state or moved to New York, Ontario, Quebec, or Vermont. The Game Commission has also been at the forefront of the fight to preserve bat populations following the unprecedented mortality caused by the presence of white nose syndrome in bats. The Game Commission developed a first-of-its-kind test to detect the presence of white nose syndrome. It's now being used across the world for disease surveillance. We have also discovered the role that temperature reduction within hibernation sites can play in stopping the spread of the disease. And in the summer of 2022, we modified a fifth bat hibernation site to better draw in cold air while venting heat out of the site. This site engineering reduces internal temperature below white nose syndrome's preferred growth zone, or the fungus, thereby decreasing disease progression and increasing bat survival. These are just some of the research projects the agency has been involved with during the past year. Others include two projects studying black bear populations, a study into the population decline of snowshoe hares, and a study of nesting sites and survival rates for northern goshawk, which included the first known inoculation of free-ranging goshawk with a vaccine for the West Nile virus. We have also made it easier for the public to play a role in helping us monitor wildlife populations. Launched in June, the Wildlife Health Survey webpage enables the public to report observations of wildlife health issues in the state. We encourage the public to report any wild birds or mammals that appear abnormal, injured, sick, or found dead. This tool has proved invaluable during the multiple wildlife health issues that emerged in the past year, including highly pathogenic avian influenza and rabbit hemorrhagic disease. Managing for healthy wildlife populations also requires providing habitat that our wildlife needs to survive. And last year, we continued our efforts with managing habitat on almost 1.6 million acres within the state game land system. More than 30,000 acres of forested habitat were improved for wildlife last year through the agency's forestry program. This includes nearly 9,300 acres of timber harvested through timber sales, more than 15,000 acres of non-timber sale forest habitat improvements, and approximately 7,000 acres treated with selective herbicides to promote native vegetation valuable to wildlife. Our crews conducted prescribed fires on 359 units for a total of 11,852 acres treated. And in the spring of 2022, we set aside over $1 million to invest in protecting game lands in our northwest, north central, northeast, and south central regions from defoliation due to damage from the spongy moth. Approximately 63,000 acres were treated using airplanes during a 16-day span in late May. This investment did a measurable good, as last year's spongy moth outbreak was substantial and caused severe damage in some areas when left untreated. We were also able to expand the size of the game land system by almost 1,400 acres. This was done through 12 land purchase contracts and donations, including 3 indentures and 4 donations of land. In addition to managing wildlife populations and providing habitat for them to survive, the third vital role that the Game Commission plays is enforcing the laws and regulations concerning wildlife. And as always, we are proud of the efforts of our state game wardens, some of the most professional, highly trained wildlife law enforcement officers in the nation. During fiscal year 2021-22, game wardens issued 4,717 warnings and initiated 5,770 prosecutions in the Pennsylvania court system. The agency was successful in 97.2% of those prosecutions, demonstrating the judgment used by our wardens when bringing charges. I'm happy to report that in February of 2022, 24 new game wardens were assigned to districts across the Commonwealth, following 45 weeks of intensive training at the Ross Loeffler School of Conservation. And then this past February, another 18 new wardens graduated and were assigned to districts as well. This constituted the third consecutive year in which a class graduated and brought our complement to full-time wardens at 204. Continuing with these efforts, we have just welcomed a new class this week as we continue to provide a much-needed law enforcement presence across the state. One thing that we try to never lose sight of at the Game Commission is that while the central component of our mission is managing wildlife in their habitats, we also have an obligation to serve the citizens of our state, both those who buy a hunting or trapping license and those who enjoy and appreciate wildlife. The recognition of that part of our mission led to some important projects this past year, such as construction of two new wildlife viewing platforms on popular game lands, State Game Lands 180 in Pike County and State Game Lands 290 just up the road on Haldeman Island in Dauphin County, to provide more opportunities for members of the public to view wildlife at these locations. We also added new shooting ranges for hunters and recreational shooters, including a rifle range on State Game Lands 44 in Elk County and archery ranges on State Game Lands 46 in Lancaster County and State Game Lands 205 in Lehigh County. In addition, shotgun patterning ranges were built at State Game Lands 205 as well as State Game Lands 109 in Erie County. Due to their popularity, we have plans to continue the expansion of the number of shooting ranges on game lands for this year, and archery ranges are currently under construction at State Game Lands 203 in Allegheny County and State Game Lands 230 in Cumberland and Perry counties. More than 40 miles of Game Commission access roads on 17 game lands were created or maintained this past year, allowing for increased access to those game lands by the public. The agency offered four wildlife live stream cameras this past year. Almost 1 million viewers tuned in to the popular cameras for an unfiltered look at wildlife in their natural settings. They watched two pairs of bald eagles constructed nests and tended eggs that hatched, with chicks growing into eaglets. They watched hundreds of thousands of snow geese and other waterfowl at our Middle Creek Wildlife Management Area, and they watched the antics of woodchucks, turkeys, deer, and elk on game lands in the heart of Pennsylvania's elk country during the elk rut in autumn. I should also add that we are currently offering a live stream of a female black bear that hibernated under the deck of a home in Pike County, and thousands of people a day tune in to watch the bear and its antics and her two cubs as they grow and get ready to emerge. To make it more efficient for members of the public to contact the Game Commission, we created a centralized dispatch operations division at our Harrisburg headquarters. Dispatchers at the center are now available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to provide great operational coverage and support to our game wardens and field staff across the state, while providing great customer service to the Pennsylvania hunters, trappers, wildlife enthusiasts, and all citizens of Pennsylvania. To date, centralized dispatchers have received and processed more than 159,000 calls from the public about everything from sick or injured wildlife to game law violations to wildlife and agency inquiries. Along with centralizing the location of the dispatch center came many important equipment upgrades, including transitioning to the use of the P25 radio system. Due to new technology available to law enforcement, including updated mapping software, in-vehicle internet capabilities, and computer-aided dispatch, centralized dispatchers can monitor wardens across the state and be in constant contact. I'd like to wrap up my remarks today by talking about what we have been able to do for hunters in recent years. That is a great source of pride for myself, our Board of Commissioners, our staff, on how we've been able to create so many more opportunities for the sportsmen and women in this state. I'll start by mentioning small game, as there are few things that are more effective at creating long-term interest in hunting. We are now offering more small game hunting opportunities now than ever before. In recent years, the Board of Commissioners has set the start of the fall squirrel season in early September, more than a month earlier than it traditionally began. This gives all hunters, but our younger hunters in particular, a chance to get an early jump on the season and experience a type of hunting that is deeply ingrained in our culture from the days of Daniel Boone and the first settlers in Penn's Woods. We have also expanded our pheasant hunting program. Our two game farms produced over 220,000 pheasants last fall. These birds were released across more than 230 properties in 62 counties. We also improved the late season by holding two after Christmas stockings, giving our hunters a good chance to find birds throughout the winter months. We continue to see a positive response to our pheasant program, as demonstrated by the fact that the number of pheasant hunting permits continues to rise, both for junior and adult hunters. We have also made an investment in dove hunting through our managed dove fields. Last fall, we expanded the number of fields in the state to over 60, spread out across all six regions and covering over 850 acres. The amount of interest in this sport is continuing to expand, and hunters who have never tried doves before are quickly learning how exciting and challenging they are to hunt. Switching to big game, the increased opportunities are almost too numerous to list. For bear hunters, we offer chances to take bear throughout the fall, archery, muzzleloader, and special firearm seasons, and then again in the traditional firearm season, which is followed by extended seasons across much of the state during the firearms deer season. This was necessary to reduce population from recent high levels that was causing conflicts with landowners, particularly farmers. We were more than happy to use our hunters to get the population under control, and in doing so, create some incredible bear hunting experiences. The resurgence of our elk population is truly a conservation success story. The Commonwealth is home to approximately 1,400 elk today. Almost 200 hunters each year get a chance to pursue some extraordinary animals that for decades were absent from our state. Turkey hunters continue to experience excellent opportunities in both the spring and fall seasons. We are particularly excited about what we have seen with poult survival over the past 2 years due to favorable weather conditions in the spring and abundance of food throughout the summer and fall. All indications are that in just a few short weeks, turkey hunters will have great opportunities to pursue gobblers all across the state. I'll let you know how it works out for me. And when it comes to deer hunting, Pennsylvania hunters are compiling some impressive numbers year after year. Just recently, the National Deer Association issued its Deer Report 2023, which provides an overview of the deer harvest within individual states and compares those numbers nationally. In this report, Pennsylvania ranked fourth nationwide in antlered deer harvest and third in the antlered harvest per square mile. For antlerless deer, Pennsylvania ranked second in total deer harvest and first in antlerless harvest per square mile. And just as encouraging is that more and more of those deer are being harvested are larger in body and in antler size than most of us have ever experienced in our lifetime, indicating a truly robust and healthy deer herd, and the product of years of science-backed management decisions. This concludes my prepared remarks. Thank you again for the opportunity to be here and discuss the ways in which we are working to create healthy wildlife populations across the state. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. I'm going to open it up to questions. Start with Representative Maloney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think I'll start with a question, and then I'd like to give other members their opportunity to ask what they may have. You can start from a list, whatever. So, Brian, I know your pie chart was sent out, and it's online, and all the other things with respect to the revenue.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned some of the things that we receive monies for, and you made a good point about some of the Ross Loeffler and law enforcement. So a question I would have with respect to that pie chart is, you stated a percentage, I think it was like 97 plus, of success with law enforcement. Do we have a figure of what that number of violations is? Like, is there a data that shows what the most common is, why, and so forth.
Yes, I'd like to bring Jason Dukoski, who is a Bureau Director for Law Enforcement.
If you could just state your name for everyone who's listening.
My name is Jason Dukoski. My name is Jason Dukoski. I'm the Bureau Director of Wildlife Protection. And the answer to Representative Maloney's question is, yes, we do. Pretty much the number one violation is any deer-related, unlawfully taken deer or wildlife, usually at night, but most of the time close season violations is the number one.
Even with as long as a season we have to harvest deer?
You're correct, yes.
Okay. So do we also, and you can get me those numbers more accurately, correct?
I could, yes.
Yeah. So on that same note, do we also have a figure of what it's costing the sportsmen with respect to defending the Game Commission's actions of lawsuits?
We don't have that figure currently, but we probably could get you something.
Okay. I'd like to have that. There's some ugly correspondence with that, as you may very well know. So that was my question with respect to that. And I'll come back, but I'd like to have the other members, whomever have their questions now, and maybe you have one for him that would suit. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Tibbett?
Notice he's on mute, so he may think he's talking.
Can you unmute, please?
I'm sorry, that was just to say that we had no audio at the beginning of the meeting.
Okay, go ahead.
That was just to say that we had no audio at the beginning of the meeting.
Oh, okay, thank you. Representative Cerisi.
Thank you, and thank you for your testimony this morning. Very intriguing. My question is on, you brought up about full staffing. The first part, and these two go together, but you may be full staffed, but are you full staffed? Like, is this really the number of what you need, or is this just the number of what we've budgeted that you need?
Yeah, we're very cautious when we look at staff, we look at the workload that needs to be done. You know, and you could argue that, yeah, there's an infinite number of staff that you could hire because there's always work that comes down. But I look at other thing we have to really examine closely is the long-term sustainability of those staff through time, because budgets, although they're very good right now thanks to gas revenues, that's not going to last forever and probably not going to last that long. So the worst real danger you have is staffing up so much and then having to lay people off, and you create a lot of insecurity among staff, things like that. But I will say we've been able to put staff, especially our game wardens, we've been able to put more officers on the ground to provide more of that customer service focus. And I think we're very well staffed up in our other portions. There's a couple other areas we're kind of continuing to examine. We do a lot of workload analysis and looking at projects and making sure, you know, if we added staff, what would be the output? So we're very output focused. If you're going to add a staff, it's got to be an output there that makes sense, and then you can long term sustain it. So I think from a staffing standpoint, you know, we're generally in pretty good shape, but we're always looking at other areas where a few here and there might help us get more accomplished on the ground.
And then, as we talk about the health of the animals themselves and the building back of the elk and the herds that we have, my big question I've seen in the last almost 5 years I've been here is the lack of veterinarians that we have in the state. We talk a lot about it on the agriculture side as far as, you know, the food supply, but how do you see what we do in game and fishery and the void? Do we have an issue with veterinarians? I mean, is there a reason for us to push for more veterinarian schools in Pennsylvania? What do you see it as?
Well, I think from our standpoint as an agency, we do have a vet on staff. In addition, that's one of the reasons we started our partnership with the University of Pennsylvania and developed the Wildlife Futures Program. So through that program, we have access to other veterinarians and all types of other technical experts, that everything from disease management to you name it. So that partnership, which is, you know, kind of developed it through a programmatic standpoint, is to be able to provide the agency those resources, technical resources and science, to help us deal with things that are always going to come up. When it comes to disease, you know, it's kind of the bug of the month. We'll always be facing and managing disease.
Thank you.
Representative Mahaffey.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Brian, thank you, and thank you to your staff. I think another year well done. Looking forward to this upcoming hunting year. Mm-hmm. So thank you for all you do. My concern, and I think where I hit on this, is avian flu. We think about the chickens, we think about eggs, we think about all that, but we don't think about what is going on as far as the poultry that you guys provide to us as hunters, whether it be pheasants, is the grouse population, whatever. I heard Wisconsin and the mid-flyway, I guess that's what they call it, snow geese got hit pretty hard with the avian flu. And then also the there's quite a few pheasant farms, I think in Wisconsin, one of them, that got hit out there. I know you buy your chicks. I know you changed that to raise more pheasants this year. And I was just wondering, have you seen anything? Is anything going on? And what are you doing to work with Secretary Redding? And how are you guys handling the avian flu?
Absolutely. And even give more detail, I asked Dr. Snoop to come up. I can give you an answer, but he'll probably have the right answer.
Sure. Thank you for your time today and bringing up that really important question. High path AI is a big issue for us, as well as my counterparts at PDA. We work closely with Dr. Brightbill at Department of Ag. So a lot of the high path AI issues come from the wild populations. We know that. And the industry guys in the poultry industry have done a fantastic job of recognizing that and responding accordingly. The backyard flock guys have really identified that. But we've also really engaged through, as was mentioned earlier, our wildlife futures program. So surveillance has increased from a few hundred pre-program to thousands post-program that we're collecting statewide. A lot of those this year have been high path AI samples. It's very important that we're able to give information to PDA of where we found wild positives. So that collaboration is a very tight one, and we still continue to collaborate with that currently and will into the future. From our farm standpoint, we've increased our biosecurity significantly on our farm, as well as Montongo, as you've mentioned earlier. Those guys, we meet with them quarterly and talk about what-ifs. There's certainly what-if situations with those guys. We're doing everything we can to help them with that, but they're probably one of the best with biosecurity, but you just never know. And so we definitely have the understanding that there's a possibility this could happen, but we have contingency plans in place, and we would just have to roll with the punches in the event that would happen.
Yeah, we were lucky to have two premier pheasant farms right above us here in the Northumberland County area. And even though I don't represent them, I know them personally, and the Martz family and so forth. And you know, I'm glad to hear that you guys are working with them and Macintongo, which is right aside of them, because that is great commerce for us as far as a state. The amount of people that come from out of state to hunt there, it's not just locals, but to hunt there and do their thing, it's really something special. And I think they said they hunt about 250,000 ringnecks themselves at Martz's farm. So I think it's pretty incredible that they put out as many ringnecks as you guys do statewide. But it's just not about what you guys do for hunters, but it's also what you're doing and working with those local communities and presenting that to them. So thank you for that. I also wanted to hit on the bear trip. It was great. My first time, I was glad to take my granddaughter. She wants to be a game warden. So that was exciting for her. The C3 cubs and the mother and what you guys do there and the biologists that took us out. Great success on that, and just wanted to thank you for that. So if I may, snow geese, have you had any with having Middle Creek and anything? Have we seen anything, or was there any possability as far as avian flu in the snow geese population in our flyway?
Sure. You're going to see high path in a lot of waterfowl. I mean, it's known, they're known carriers. We didn't see a a large amount, if you will, but our surveillance did take them into consideration, and we really we are actively looking for them as well as vultures and some of those more susceptible species.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thank you, Madam Chair.
And Representative Labs.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for being here today. Just two brief questions. First, could you just touch on CWD in the state, what that looks like, what we're doing to stave that off and mitigate that?
Yep, so CWD in disease management area specifically, two, where it started, it's the prevalence has continued to climb. We continue to follow our response plan for CWD. We continue to provide testing for hunters. In fact, through our Wildlife Futures program, we've been able to cut the response time down from 2 to 3 weeks down to under 7 days. So we've been able to really provide some better customer service of getting hunters the results of their CWD testing. We're actually starting a new research project in disease management area two to look at what impacts CWD is going to have at the population level. And also that'll help us explore what additional strategies or tactics we can use to try to slow down the spread of CWD. The reality of CWD is unless technology or something changes, there's no way to get rid of it. So it's about slowing it down as much as you can. So we continue to follow the response plan. It's not cheap. We're probably spending about $4 million working with chronic wasting disease. It's a very expensive disease, but all the other states that have CWD are dealing with the same issues that we are as well.
Thank you very much. And I guess this is more of a comment, but just wondering if there's any new programs or anything additional that we're doing for veterans. And if not, I'd be happy to have a conversation with you offline about maybe anything we can improve or do differently, make better, just to make sure that this, they're all accounted for.
I'd love to have that conversation. I know a lot of our NGO partners, whether our NWTF, Pheasants Forever, do some vet events. And I know Commissioner Schnepp Geiger, she volunteers up an event up in the northwest part of the state, but love to sit and discuss about more opportunities that we can provide.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Thanks.
Thank you. And we do welcome Representative Mirsky from Erie County, and he will speak now.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for your testimony today, Brian. I did have a question. In Western Pennsylvania, East Palestine, Ohio, right across the border, a lot of people in Western Pennsylvania are hunters, and a lot of folks there, they hunt for food. And so we know, I was at a hearing there for with agriculture and DEP, and they're telling everyone, don't drink the water. Well, our wild game, they don't know to not drink the water. So is there anything that the Game Commission is doing, either in coordination with DEP or with Department of Ag, to monitor the situation and the wildlife that is, obviously they don't know political borders, so that cross over from Ohio to Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I'd like to ask Dr. Schnoop and also Dave Gustafson, who is our Bureau of Wildlife Habitat Management, and can maybe provide some updates on the game lands or activities that we've had up there.
Sure. So let me start by thanking for that question. It is a big deal. I get that question from I'm from that area. So, of course, you can imagine the phone calls I get from my parents and friends and family. So what we found, and we've worked closely with the Ohio Department of Wildlife as well. And so they hired contractors, and then luckily we had in place our Wildlife Futures program. So we were ready to go for that kind of event. And basically what we've did is our regional staff was fantastic in the immediate response of identifying issues that could pop up. And so we had this immediate response, but then we also had a consistency within that area in relation to other parts of the state. Because if you go out looking for dead things, you're going to find dead things, right? So do we find more dead things because of this? And fortunately, we did not. And actually, neither did Ohio on their end either. They found a couple of possums and things like that, but nothing that you would have expected broadly. One of the difficulties of this specific issue is that the diagnostic testing for that specific pollutant is very hard to test the animal for and tie it directly. You know, water quality, you can go out there, and we all saw the guy, you know, the local, I guess he was the local mayor. Yeah, right. So you can test that. You can test the soil. But for specifically tying it back to wildlife, we can't do that because the diagnostic testing isn't there. And so, but what we were able to do is see that we didn't see a big increase, and it was nice working collaboratively with the Ohio Department that they didn't either. And so, so we're continuing to monitor that the best we can.
Thank you. So, to the best of your knowledge, the wildlife, if we hunt, and it's safe to eat.
That's correct.
Thank you.
However, we would be cautious to really answer that directly from what we've seen and from a department. That would really be a Department of Health standpoint. Recommendation, but from what we've seen, we have not seen it impact the populations.
Are you working in coordination with Department of Health?
Yeah, Betsy Schroeder is working closely with our veterinarians that was brought up earlier, Andrew DeSalvo.
We could get some communication out to that Western PA, especially that Beaver County area, Allegheny County in there. I think that would be beneficial for everybody.
Yep, absolutely. Thank you.
Did you have someone else on this topic, or we?
He told me. He said he didn't have anything to add.
Thank you. Representative Pielli.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, sir, for your presentation today. It was mentioned about veterans. I'm a veteran myself, and I vaguely recall my first time I was returning from active duty that Pennsylvania had a program where licensing was pretty much streamlined for veterans. So pardon my ignorance, but is that still in place now?
Yeah, because it does get complicated, so I'll ask Dunlap.
Good morning.
Morning.
So we do have separate licenses that are set up for veterans, and they do go through, some of them go through the county treasurer's office specifically. So we do have ways to help them to, dependent upon, I guess, if they had a disability or something like that, then they could apply for specific licenses for hunting to help them.
I remember, and I think this is going back to 1995 for the first time, and I went into a Kmart, and I showed my DD-214, my discharge paper, and I was able to walk out with a license, a deer hunting license. So that's no longer the case now?
No, certain veterans, it really depends on if they have a disability, but veterans can get a license at any of our agents out there.
Okay.
But if there's specific situations, as I said, with a disability, then they may have to actually go to a county treasurer office specifically.
And could you speak to me about, I'm interested in legislation that seemed to have a lot of bipartisan support. I believe it was HB 490 last session. And it's regarding reciprocity with other states who allow veterans to hunt for free. And are you familiar with that legislation? Or maybe if you're not, if you could just speak to me about if Pennsylvania has any reciprocity agreements with neighboring states regarding hunting license.
Not currently that I'm aware of.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Representative Adams.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One question, two comments. If there are any studies out there on the apparent growing population of coyotes and fishers on the deer and turkey population. I live in an area that the largest landowner is the state, Delaware State Forest and Game Lands, and then many large hunting clubs. I've had many people come and say they've hunted every single day in deer season and haven't seen a deer. And the bear population obviously has had an impact on that as well. So that's one question. Communications regarding the change in the application and way to get a DOE license, if there's going to be some big push there, because it seems to be a confusion area for many people. And the last question is, can you make any comments regarding the Saturday start versus Monday start scenario for traditional deer season? It seems to be a very popular thing for constituents to be asking all of us regarding how you know, economic impacts and cultural impact and kids and working families and all those types of things. So thank you.
You hit every top button we got. So let me start my favorite, the fisher. There's a lot of research that's been done on fishers to look at the food habits and what they eat. I, throughout my career, have never seen an animal that's blamed for everything under the moon like I've seen the fisher. You know, this it is a predator. There's no doubt about it. You look at, for example, they get blamed for turkeys. I heard one group, they were talking about it at a sportsman show, and they said, well, I know they're getting them out of the trees, and they're getting them while they're nesting in the trees. And I had the heart tell them that turkeys don't nest in trees. They nest on the ground. But it seems intuitive that they would be a major predator on turkeys when, in fact, the research doesn't show that at all. For example, I was fall turkey hunting this past fall, and I saw my first fisher. I was so excited. We saw plenty of turkeys. I mean, my turkey dog was busy as can be. And I looked down in the woods and saw that fisher, so I grabbed my dog's collar and I just held on to him because my dog's a bit of a baby and he'd lose with a fisher. But so the fisher always gets blamed for everything. And if you look in North America, really there's a culture of bias against predators. Predators in, say, the western United States where you're dealing with wolves and grizzly bears, and it's a different type of thing, and there's different issues that they face in the western United States as compared to the eastern United States. But coyotes have been here, we know, since the 1930s. You know, a coyote is, you know, a generalist. They're eating a lot of different things. You know, a lot of the research is, when you look at turkeys, for example, their survival is very high. Once they get past a certain age, which, you know, after a few months, they can fly, they can run. And that's why turkeys hang out in groups, because all those eyes are looking. And I've personally watched coyotes try to sneak up on a flock of turkeys, and they just kind of look at them and separate. And then the bobcat figures, well, they see me, so there's no sense to waste energy. Could a coyote or a fisher eat a turkey? Yeah, but we're not seeing any evidence that is having any impact from a population standpoint. Because remember, most of these predators, rarely are they very specific in their food diet. They're not selecting any one thing. Pretty much where you see turkey mortality, the highest level is going to be during nesting. And that nesting could usually, it's probably a random interaction. It could be anything. It could be a raccoon. It could be a possum. It could be a skunk. It could be a bear, you know. Everything wants to eat turkeys. But remember, turkeys and other prey species, they basically were born to be eaten by something. That's why turkeys have 9 to 10 eggs. That's why they can re-nest if they lose their first nest. And in fact, I always argue that if we truly had a predator problem, we wouldn't have had the past 2 years of high turkey poult survival in the state that we've seen. So it was merely a function of adequate spring weather, which has driven turkey populations forever. I've seen it my entire career. You know, deer, do deer mainly fawns, they do get depredated or predated by predators. You know, in some of the research that we've done, it's either bobcats, coyotes, bears, and about 50% of the fawns are basically taken by predators. That's normal. So does that impact deer hunting? No, because we actually manage the state's antler or deer population through antlerless license allocations. So if predators were taking too many, you could bring down the antlerless allocations, and then that population would be fine. So predators are a natural part of the environment. But they unfortunately get blamed. We have a very much of a cultural bias against predators, because oftentimes when you look at Europeans when they came into the country, you know, bringing their livestock, they didn't have the fences we have today. And we had larger predators like wolves and mountain lions in the state at that time. And, yeah, they're trying to make a livelihood. We're not faced with that. We don't have wolves. We don't have mountain lions. You know, it's they get blamed for everything. So any more questions on that? Okay. That's one of my favorite questions, by the way. I love that one. So the doe licenses, we planned that out. It's basically going to look like, as far as the timing and the rounds, it's going to be almost identical to before. The only difference this time is when you go buy your license, you get your doe license. But it's going to be first come, first serve, just like before. There'll be the different rounds, so you'll have the first round, second round, third round. So it'll pretty much be structured that same way. We have already mapped out our communications because it's kind of early. We have talked about it in the board meeting, but we're going to have communications to all hunters as we get closer to the license season. So if you got it to them too early, you'd probably forget by the time that season come up. So we ramped out our marketing team is already on point with that and moving that. So then the other topic, which I think I've heard debate over, the Saturday or Sunday opener. So, you know, I think I've talked to the Federation of Sportsman Clubs the other day, and one of my messages was, never It's one of the issues that I've seen where sportsmen started to fight other sportsmen. It's something we should not do. You know, we have to all recognize, whether we're on the Saturday side or the Monday side, there are good reasons and feelings on both sides of the argument. A person who wants a Saturday opener has a legitimate feeling because those are his or her feelings, and that's legitimate by itself. And a person who wants to maintain the heritage of the Monday opener, that's their opinion and feelings, and that's what makes it legitimate because that's how they feel. So we shouldn't be picking on each other. Are there some benefits to the Saturday opener that were provided? Yes, absolutely. Through our surveys, we found that some of the reactivated hunters came back because of not only Saturday opener, but because of Sunday. Did that ruin or interfere with traditions of those who liked the Monday opener? Absolutely. But it did have an impact, a positive impact on licensed sales. Did licensed sales go in the positive direction? No, but the rate of decline dramatically slowed down. And kind of like being in a car wreck and you're bleeding everywhere. You want to stop the hemorrhaging anywhere you can. So that's kind of what we're looking at. You know, we found through our survey that 61% of the hunters actually did support the Saturday opener. They liked it. And another 17% were kind of, I don't care what you do either way. And then around 22% said they didn't like it. We found that hunters over 55 tended to not like the Saturday opener, and hunters under 54 liked the Saturday opener. And especially if they were hunting with kids, for obvious reasons, because most kids have more time to hunt at that time. But it's unfortunately, you know, when I look at the move that was made, and you know, I could still respect and empathize with everybody who has a feeling on one side or another. Obviously, this was never put in place to hurt anybody. But the fact of the matter is, any time a regulation is changed, it does going to hurt somebody. You have to appreciate and empathize with that. Nobody else should have questions after that question.
Oh, we have some more. Representative Banta.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm new, and I'm very excited to be here and be part of this. I live in a farm in Waterford, Pennsylvania, about 15 miles south of Erie. I've hunted all my life. I love to hunt. My kids hunt. I've seen in the last, you know, couple decades, the decline often in kids that are doing, you know, electronic games and not getting out in the woods. Of course, I'm doing my part up there. I'm sure you guys are too. But my real question is, what do you do for marketing to bring these kids out, get the kids out in the woods? What do you spend and how do you do that? What is your marketing strategy for bringing kids back to the woods or getting them out there, the new kids? I ask this question because several years ago, I went to a little school in my area and asked the kids if they wanted to wrestle, because I used to wrestle in a school up there. And four or five of the little kids, they didn't know what they were talking about, but they raised their hand. Five of those kids were in Hershey 3 weeks ago. So if you get out there and influence the kids and tell them about it, what it is, and get them out in the woods and show them about what it is, we're going to bring hunting back, and, you know, and fishing, of course. Again, the electronics doesn't help. And so, again, my question is, what are you doing for marketing, and how much are you spending to do it? Thanks. Okay.
I'll bring up Matthew Moret, who is oversees our marketing bureau, and I'll bring up Steve Smith, who is actively engaged in a number of activities from the Bureau of I&E. But while they're on their way up, you know, a lot of what we do as an agency is look for barriers. So what are the barriers for people to get into hunting and trapping? One of the barriers was always and continues to be, for example, having your hunter safety before you go out and hunt. So one of the biggest, probably the biggest tools that the agency Board of Commissioners did was create the Mentored Youth Program, which basically some call it the try it before you buy it opportunity. So you, as a youth or even an adult, you can try hunting as long as you're with a mentor and try hunting out, but within 3 years, you're going to have to get your hunter safety. So that's an example of one of the barriers. Now, we're seeing this as a national type of trend, is that, number one of the things that we're finding, and we've known this, is competition for organized sports. Everybody thinks little Jimmy is going to be a professional football player, or at least a scholarship at Penn State. So organized sports definitely, absolutely compete with hunting. We're also seeing just a trend, which I can't explain, of fewer and fewer youth that are coming into the sport of hunting and trapping. But I'll let Matthew, you want to start out? hit the red light, green light.
Here we go.
There you go.
On the marketing side of things, there's many ways that we try to engage all constituents, all residents of Pennsylvania, but we do drill down a lot for the recruitment efforts, which we share with Steve Smith. You know, a few of the things, you know, if you look at our social media presence on all platforms, it's continuing to grow. Our team is engaging on all aspects of what we do, but we do really pinpoint a lot of our youth activities to try to, you know, increase that awareness. You know, we have roughly 300,000 organic followers to all of our platforms. And when you look at that as a state agency for, you know, specifically for wildlife, it's pretty tremendous. Open rates on our direct emails are, you know, in the 40%. And, you know, we're getting that information out there on a very timely basis, strategically communicating to that. And then we take it another step is our, you know, in-person outreach, where we're doing stuff from the high-level shows like the NRA show that happened here in Harrisburg and all over the state, where that R3 effort is a big proponent. We just got through from last weekend with our National Archery in the Schools State Archery Tournament, where 1,000 school-age kids came and competed in National Archery in the Schools. And that is a big recruitment effort, too, on the youth of our state, where, you know, it generates about 5,000 people to go through the hunter education course every year. So, you know, our efforts are laser focused from our whole agency when it comes to young folks.
Good morning, and thank you for that question. And I'll echo right off the bat what Matt just said. It is a multifaceted, all hands on deck approach for the agency. There's been so much that we've done in recent years, not just for younger hunters, but to get new hunters in general. Because, I mean, we don't care if they're young, we don't care if they're 12, we don't care if they're 50, whatever. It's just we want more hunters to increase participation, increase support for hunting. So there's a lot that we've done, as Matt talked about, as Brian talked about, and even what was brought up earlier with the Saturday opener. In talking to our board, the intent there was to get more people involved in hunting. And if you look at the numbers that we've put together, and we'd be happy to share them with you, since the board made that change, we've seen more younger hunters stay with hunting. As Brian said, the decline was going down, and then you look at that age group, 18 to 35, not declining at the same rate it was. It just, on its face, you would have to assume some of that is because, you know, those individuals who might have missed hunting due to being in college, being at work, are now having that weekend to hunt. So a lot of what our board has done is take steps to increase hunting participation. At the program level for the Game Commission, as Brian mentioned, we've made Hunter Ed more accessible. We've created an online program to go with the in-person program. Certainly, COVID forced us to get there, but we're there, and it's turning out to be a good thing. We measure the rates there to make sure that we're not seeing an increase in any hunting-related incidences or violations from those who are going through the online classes, and we're not. After a couple years' worth of data, we have every reason to believe that going through that online platform is successful in creating new hunters. We also do additional programs. For instance, we've been recently down in Philadelphia for the past couple of years doing mentored hunts down in that area with John Hines National Wildlife Refuge, which is right outside the city limits of Philly. So we're talking about individuals who probably never would have had an opportunity to learn about hunting, but we're taking them there onto the refuge, giving them a chance to experience hunting. And while those numbers are, you know, sort of difficult to say that's going to make an impact, that program in and of itself, but what we're seeing is those individuals who participate are telling other people. For instance, one young hunter who went through it, when it was his turn in his high school to do a presentation, he did a presentation about harvesting a deer at John Hines and how he cooked his meals with the venison. And this is for a high school down in Philadelphia where there's, again, probably a lot of individuals who would not have heard about hunting if not for the fact that he was there, got to experience it, and now is telling others. He's an advocate [S2] Sure. [S1] Of himself. We've also put resources into what we call a Learn to Hunt program. We're finding one thing that's really unique about us right now as an agency is so many people are reaching out to us saying, I've heard about hunting, I'd like to do it, I just don't know anything about it. And that's, you know, very unusual in the years past. There was always that line of succession. Somebody had a granddad, a dad, father, mother, teach them. Now we're having people who said, nobody's here to teach me. So we've created online curriculums called the Learn to Hunt program. These are webinars. We've covered a lot of species from small game, squirrels, pheasants, turkey, to deer, to take those individuals, and it's not just youth. Again, it could be individuals of any age, and give them an opportunity to learn the skills so that they say, okay, I'm ready to go give it a try. I'm going to go buy a license and become a hunter. So So those are just a handful. I'd be happy to show you our full program that we put together. We've adopted an R3 plan that we're going to implement for the next couple of years that's just going to be really focused on recruiting hunters.
Thank you so much. Yeah, that's the name of the game, getting awareness out there, getting the kids excited about it. Like I said, whatever it's worth, these kids didn't know nothing about wrestling. And then just the other day they were at States. I was so proud. It's because I just said something that day and they got into it, and it went from there. They're just grown, disciplined, strong men on the mat, and I was absolutely proud. So I think that's the same thing with your program there. If you get people out there and they really embrace hunting and, you know, just the idea that, you know, kids today especially spend their time with their head in the phone. You know, so hopefully we can get them in the woods. Thanks for your time, Tesma.
I think we should promote wrestling because I actually quit football when I was in high school and wrestled because it didn't interfere with the hunting season.
Thank you. Representative Haddock.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Kulik, Executive Director Bernans, how are you?
Very good.
Good. You lightly talked about the decline of current license sales in the state of Pennsylvania, and I believe you said that it's slowed. What numbers are we at, and what projection would you have for next year as far as just an adult hunting license sales?
Yeah, right now we're seeing, before about 2018, we were seeing somewhere between 3.5% to 4.5% decline in base licenses every single year, fairly mirroring what we saw in other states as well. And all the states, for some reason, started to, about the early 1980s is when that decline started. And it's been very, very steady throughout that time. Right now, when we look at hunting license sales, the number of units, let's see, right now, this year, or for 2022, 861,966 licenses last year. So, you know, where are we going to see? We're probably going to continue to see, this is discussed quite a bit amongst different agencies, is we're probably going to see that same slow trend, 2.5%, but there's a point where it's going to bottom out. I mean, this isn't going to go to zero. I don't think there's anybody who thinks hunting numbers are going to go to zero, but what is that bottom number? That's what we don't know. So I anticipate, based on what we're seeing, of course, we've got a lot of new programs that we're implementing that Steve and Matt talked about, and what change that'll happen. There's a whole community within the hunting community that's really focused on R3. Some would actually argue, and with a valid argument, that we, you know, less hunters is, you know, hunters that are left are going to be able to have more hunting opportunities. There's all kinds of arguments on both sides that even within the hunting community. But we're going to continue to try to, you know, create more opportunities and engage anybody who wants to get started in hunting. So I would anticipate, if I had a magic ball, you know, we're probably going to see that 2 to 3% decline. But you know, we had a couple of years where it's just one, so it's just kind of work our way through it.
Okay, thank you. Following up with Representative Adams' question on the new program for selling the DOE licenses, I heard in your answer education to the hunter or the purchaser, but the other half of that is our selling agents. And my question is twofold. Are we, because we've changed, and I have no problem with that. I think congratulations on getting that done before I got here, because that would have been one of my issues. So, you know, we've changed drastically the old-fashioned way of going through the county treasurer system, and we need to educate. But as most of us know, you walked in your favorite sporting goods store on the Friday before the Monday, or the Saturday, there was lines. Now we've changed the dynamics of this. A lot of hunters procrastinate, and deer is the number one driver to sell hunting licenses. They waited to the last minute. Now the interesting here, I feel that the last minute might be Monday when the sale of the DOE license actually starts. And of course, now they need the proper staffing. And I realize there's only one terminal in probably all the stores or most of our licensing outlets. But are they going to know, being the sellers, and especially some of the chains, hopefully they realize the volumes that they're going to get hit from possibly they might get twofold. They might still have the day, couple days before, and then people are going to be told, oh, you can come back Monday right here, and we'll sell you the license again. So that education piece, is that being done with our vendors?
Yeah, we routinely communicate with our vendors. You have to remember, though, within this system, and this gets a little techie, is the vendors, like Walmart, they have a different line. They have a direct line into the system to process those license sales, whereas, and Danny, you can correct me if I either incorrect or I now should say, wow, he was listening to me. The consumer, like myself, I'm going to go online, so and everybody else is going to do that. So there's two different routes. So there will be no doubt, you know, going to be lines. I mean, it's like the grocery store before Thanksgiving. There's always a line. Or, you know, when you go online and you're trying to order your license, is it going to slow down? It probably will, because anybody who tried to use your debit card at the gas station during or Christmas Day, notice that everything runs slow. So do we anticipate there's going to be some slowness or some long lines? Absolutely. We won't know until we get through the process for the first year how this is going to change how hunters want to purchase their licenses. You know, it could be that most people just go online and say, well, that's the easiest thing to do, as most of us do. Or they may just want to go into Walmart, or they might want to walk into their county treasurer and purchase it just like they typically do when they're in the department store or whatnot. So we anticipate that at the peak times, yeah, it's going to get tough, and it's going to slow the system down. But, you know, we anticipate that. We've been working with our vendor for some time. You know, this is really nothing new. If you look at our system, we've been selling licenses online for years. We sold DMAP, which is kind of equivalent to what an antlerless license with no issue. In fact, DMAP goes on sale at 12 midnight, and I have some colleagues that are crazy enough sitting behind me that they stay up until 12:01 so they can purchase their DMAP. And it does slow down a little bit, but, you know, it's been able to run through. So we're going to continue to monitor and learn about how this is going to change purchasing behavior, and there's a lot we'll learn from this.
Okay. Thank you. And feral pigs, can you tell us how many counties they're in Pennsylvania currently, and to what kind of possible kills we've had with feral pigs?
Matthew, I have not heard.
I spent 15 years in Texas, and I can tell you we don't want any. Wildlife Services, USDA Wildlife Services, does a fantastic job of responding to any of the pigs that would be considered feral. And they've immediately responded. I can't tell you a hard number, but I do know that they are very hard. They're very hard on the pigs. If they've found any free ranging or anything like that, they respond almost immediately.
Are you aware of any free ranging now?
I'm not aware of it. No.
Okay. I thought I saw some figures on that, and you're actually talking to a sportsman that took two in Bradford County.
There you go.
And reported it, and they were tested. So.
Right. Great. Did you work with USDA with those?
No, reports? Actually, the Game Commission directly.
Okay great.
The officer responded first, and
well, I'm happy to reach out to my counterpart at Wildlife Services and see if I can't find you some better numbers on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. And the last comment, Brian. As you know, we've had a discussion on Fishers, and they are a predator, and they you know were released by our Game Commission years ago, and they're here to stay. But, you know, again, the growth of the fisher population throughout the state of Pennsylvania. Now, how many counties are they in?
Matthew?
That's a good question. I'm going to have to report back to you on that as well, the total number of counties the fishers are in. You're absolutely right. They've done fantastically well, though.
And they have. I hope we're not getting into releasing more predators. But not only our state have they grown tremendously, but I'm sure if they ran through Pennsylvania, as we talked about earlier, our animals don't know the county lines and the state lines. So we've affected some other states with our fisher stocking program or reintroduction program. So, but we may want to look at, too, with the growth of fishers. I think there's even more opportunity to trap, because I still think there's a very limited, it might even be one, we might be able to bump that up for our fur taker opportunities to have more action in the field. Okay?
You bet.
Thank you.
And just a point of note on that, the fishers were, yes, the agency did release some, and they also came in from West Virginia, in other words, natural expansion of the range. So they came in two different fronts. But again, as I was talking about before, you know what? Guess what the number one prey item of the fisher is?
Fish.
Other fishers.
Oh.
So everybody wants to paint the fisher as this evil demon. If they don't see any turkeys or don't see any deer, everybody blames the fisher. I'm telling you, I see it every single day of my career here. I've never seen an animal get painted in such a negative way when it does not deserve the reputation it does.
Well, I've heard you say that before, but I'm just going to throw out a little history of Pennsylvania real quick. Gary Ault was the number one bear biologist in this state for years, and he was probably one of the most intelligent bear biologists in the country. He took over the deer population after the fact, and he was shocked at the fawn mortality rate that bears actually take, and it took him taking over the deer population to find that fact out.
Yeah, and
so until they're actually studied heavy, we don't know the effects of fishers yet.
Well, fishers
in my mind.
Studied. Fishers have been studied. But I understand, you know, here's when it comes to personal values. I understand. I empathize with how you're feeling there. As a scientist, I just don't have the data that supports that going that way. Just because we don't see something doesn't necessarily mean it's because of that. So, but I respect that. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Matthew.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Representative Gergely.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My original question would now be redundant, that is, was pertaining to the Saturday-Monday opener. Large amount of constituents of the 35th District, very passionate, very vocal about that issue. So thank you for addressing that. I just have two quick comments. One, now that question has been answered, please continue to do everything you can to keep up in advance the youth marketing. I think that's an integral part of their youth, and very important they have that experience and that exposure. And also, I wanted to mention that I find the bear camp very entertaining. Keep that up. That's very peaceful and strangely entertaining in a way. So good job with that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair Maloney.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate the involvement with the members. I felt it was very important. In past, we didn't necessarily always have the time, and I appreciate that for those who are new. A few things I want to touch on, Brian, and to others that are in this room. Some things are, well, I appreciate the last representative talking, because with respect to some of the things that have been said in the past, it isn't always the biologist who knows or the science behind the so-called data. And I believe a lot of times the sportsman who you are to be serving is sort of marginalized and disrespected in that fact. You know, in my 50th year of hunting, there's a lot of things I could say, and I don't believe it's exactly something you want to hear. But there are things that we've observed, there are things that we've experienced, and we can't be marginalized. The fact that Gary Ault did not, I was the one who challenged him in Harrisburg long before I came here on what he was doing with the bear, and the fact that he did not know that they were the number one predator to the fawn. I don't know how you do analyzations of stomach and intestines and stools and not know or even get onto that track. And so when I think that I hear things about, yeah, they're predators, yeah, but predators prey. And as I have stated here many times since coming here, we're now doing controlled burns, which we didn't before. Kudos to you for that. But I got nothing but excuses when it came to those things. And a marten is a predator. And to think that you're going to reintroduce something that was gone for 120 years, to me seems like there's much more priority in what we have in front of us, just like it took me 10 years to get hunter safety course in school, which you should be monopolizing on. 500 school districts. Reach out with the marketing to those schools to have those online programs or even in person. I'll give you a short story. So I raise turkeys. I raise pheasants also. And I do have one of the biggest pheasant farms in the district who you bought from. However, You know what took my Tom out? A weasel. Now, you might say from the weasel family that the Martin being a superior one doesn't necessarily combat with that population of turkey. You'll never convince me or other hunters who have seen some of those interactions. Do we expect some? I would think so. I think predators do what they can. But to have a confined cage, to have my 7.5-year-old Tom be killed by a weasel is significant when that thing is how small compared to Martin, loves to prey on squirrels, loves to prey on any kind of eggs that are in the woods. And to my first pet peeve coming in here is our state bird. So I know of one place that you're doing some sort of study for the grouse. I would like a follow-up on that and also anything else that would be pertinent to our state bird, which I think is extremely important. And if you think of predation and farming techniques and all the other things that I know of, look, I know some of you people come from the National Turkey Federation. It isn't something I don't think is new to you. But I do believe there's a dynamic in Pennsylvania that has to do with maybe our own particular nuances. Even supporting and, you know, listening to the sportsmen is not something that I hear is positive, which is why I want to go back to that Saturday opener. That Saturday opener was started by a commissioner who rescinded the idea, and the numbers that were given to us were false because we knew it was more like 80, but even you even used 60 or 62% of the hunters said no. I don't take a position on it for the simple reason that hunting has always been a priority to me. But I can tell you something you all continue to hit on today. The interaction with kids. The interaction with kids on a Saturday, especially the holiday weekend, is probably one of the worst conflicts that you can have. I think that's just, like, obvious. I'm a PIAA official. I was a school director. And I'll give you another story about what we did with the churches in the area. On a Saturday and a Sunday, we asked the pastors to come together, and they brought all the youth groups together and said, please do not schedule your soccer, field hockey, baseball before 1 a.m. or 1 o'clock p.m. in the afternoon, maybe 2 o'clock. They all conceded and said, we'll do that. Why? Because it was a conflict of family time. I got a text message when the Game Commission finally did that Saturday opener from an NRA lobbyist. Now, I'm not going to repeat the verbiage that he used, but I'm going to give you a condensed version of it. What the blank were they thinking people will get divorced over this? Now, if you can't read into that family conflict, I can't help you. But having said that, Brian, there are so many different issues that I think we would do better with a little bit more sportsman conflict, or I mean sportsman communication. And so even on the CWD, as many of you know, I worked hard to get that $1 million in the budget, which is long gone and dispersed. I didn't hear anything about the report on that $250,000 spent on dog sniffers. But to me, there's a lot of questions that I get bombarded with, not just because press wants to talk to me or because sportsmen across the state know that I've hunted in their district or they know to reach out to me. They don't necessarily get good answers. I think you touched on the fact that there is a concern that CWD would find its way to a human conflict. And I think you're trying to combat the fact that we don't think that can happen, but we don't know that it couldn't. Isn't that correct? Correct. So So this is some of the things that's happening, because now what we're having is we're having sportsmen who are participating to some extent, but donating their food because they don't want the conflict. To me, that's hurtful. I've raised my children on venison. I think that's a troubling trend if it continues. And the grouse, with respect to, I think you use it, you called it a genetically distinct sort of testing. Am I to understand that you mean that you're trying to delineate whether or not genetically and geographically that these grouse have some sort of new challenge? Is that correct?
Well, they're looking to see if they're distinct populations. In other words, are they separated? Is there some barrier that doesn't allow for exchange of genetic material?
So they're a very private bird. They're very, I guess, specific to even mating in that regard, I guess. But what do you know about the habitat, which has always been an issue for me? What do we know about the habitat changes or lack thereof that you think is affecting them?
Oh, it's absolutely a combination of lack of habitat and West Nile virus. Both those factors have kind of a double whammy on our rough grouse population. I have to remember, the Pennsylvania Game Commission only owns 1.6 million or million acres. State's a lot bigger. We have no control of what happens on private lands. And in fact, if you look throughout the eastern United States when it comes to forestry activities, because the eastern United States has a big forestry program, where I'm talking South Carolina, I'm talking Pennsylvania, it's actually the timber markets would drive a lot of these populations, such as whether it's bobwhite quail in the southeast or rough grouse here in Pennsylvania. There's external private market forces that will drive what happens with timber. And I could bring Mr. Guffson up if we wanted to get into some more detail on that. But we do know that it's habitat watch, is why the agency has put into place some pretty intense habitat management on the lands that we manage. And we also work with DCNR as well to do as much rough grouse habitat management as we can. But we're also looking at other things, like could it possibly be genetic diversity or lack of genetic diversity that could be having some type of an impact. So we're trying to cover all our bases and look at all things and to find that out.
Do you find a conflict with the foresting best practices? I know that certain turkey gurus across the country think that the visual problem for turkeys has risen to a factor where they don't feel comfortable because they can't see, and because the poults are so small, they'll move their poults or avoid a certain area. And so when you're regenerating forests, maybe, do you think that there's any issue with that? I'm just interested in it more so than concerned, because I just never really saw that before. I tended to think that they love to duck and hide. But I'm seeing some things recently in other states that they're saying that, you know, if they can't see, they're not going to feel comfortable. But we're not really noticing that, right?
No. And in fact, that what we call that early successional habitat, that young forest, is actually very beneficial for turkeys, especially they'll feed on the edge. You're right. That duck and hide is really important for wild turkeys. In fact, if you go down to North Georgia, North Florida, South Georgia, some of these big quail plantations where it's basically longleaf pine and grass, and it's pretty high and thick, those places are just have incredible turkey populations. They have great nesting cover, great brood rearing habitat, and they can escape predators.
So I know you mentioned that you did some catch and release for turkeys in certain, I think you actually mentioned 4 units. One of them happens to be the one I live in. And I was contacted by the agency to go on a trapping adventure, which never happened, because they told me that they were having difficulty even locating flocks. So speak to that a little bit.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons that wildlife management unit was selected, to try to look at what's going on in that unit. We have other units, you know, southwest and northeast. Turkey populations are doing fantastic. North central turkeys are doing really well. Why is the southeast? As I look at the southeast landscape, it looks pretty good for turkeys to me. And I grew up in Montgomery County. So that's one of the things we're trying to answer the question, is why are turkeys not doing so well in that portion of the state?
So there is a great possibility that predation is a problem.
specific to your wildlife management unit?
Yeah.
We don't know.
But in some respects, though, at times you'll be for sure that you do know, or that you don't like the fact that people have their opinion and it conflicts with what you may or may not have learned. So that's why I see this conflict with how we cannot think that there's a geographical dynamic going on in an area, which I've kept my eyes on for over 40 years. The turkeys aren't there. There's a predation problem that is extensive, which I and others have tried to curtail. But the fact of the matter is, that is an issue that I'm not saying can be fixed in a short period of time, because when you have possums and coons and fox that all love those eggs, and you do have weather issues, I get it. But you have those weather issues most times more extreme in other parts of the state. So that's why I was trying to concentrate on some of the area that where they're not there anymore, you know. And so that was something that I wanted to touch on, because I do believe that there is a predation issue that is sort of missed, because I don't know if you're spending any more money on the bald eagle, but they have moved into most neighborhoods where there's any kind of water supply and any kind of fish that we're also stocking. And they seem to be doing very well on, I mean, you'll see them on a roadkill sometimes. Opportunity, I get it. But I already had them, you know, come down on groundhogs that I had laying in a field that I had just dispatched, and get into a conflict with a red-tailed hawk or anything else. And so it seems to me that there is a bigger predation problem that we are having, and maybe it's more geographical, but which also concerns me, because like with a marten, which can take out a snowshoe, can take out the squirrels, and look, they're not going to just say we're known to prey on mice and voles, so thus that's what we're going to stick with. They're also opportunists. And so for me, I just don't see why we would look at, with habitat issues and predation issues, that we would then spend the energy and the effort on another predator. So, Brian, I'm gonna wrap some of this up, because we don't get a lot of opportunity. Many of us are contacted by constituents and people who have a lot of questions, and we don't always have the opportunity, nor do we have some of the interaction to be able to give those answers in the same way that we are elected officials to answer other agency issues or other legislative issues. So in some respects, I think a once a year sort of meet and greet doesn't really suffice. But I'm going to go to my last subject, which is the elk. And you mentioned something, I think you said almost 200 in your testimony as far as elk licenses. I think the number is actually 170, right?
Yeah.
So 30 away from 200, but 170. I don't remember off the top of my head what the ratio is of residents versus non-residents. Do you?
Yes. It's between 9 and 13% it generally runs. It's equivalent to the percentage that apply that are non-residents.
Okay, so you probably won't be surprised to hear that no matter where I go, Pennsylvania residents want to be first. And they take offense to the fact that so many non-residents get those licenses. Do we fix it legislatively and force your hand? Maybe. But that's the voice of Pennsylvania. Whether it's a success or whether it's not a success, the sportsmen of Pennsylvania want an opportunity. And to me, that is a problem. And Those numbers that you have with the elk, I think, are a little bit more easy for you to follow, just like they are with the bear. But it also brings me to the point about you used the National Deer Association's deer report as to the numbers of deer in Pennsylvania. Where do you think they got those numbers?
Those numbers, like was mentioned, are given by the agency, and all the agencies provide that data to the National Deer Association, who then puts those numbers together.
What agencies are you referring to?
Well, in my respect, the Pennsylvania Game Commission.
So what other agencies would be giving those numbers to a national agency?
Each individual state wildlife agencies would be giving those numbers to the National Deer Association.
So they're coming out with numbers that we are in the state somewhere providing them.
Correct.
But they're estimated.
Correct.
Okay. So I think it's also a little gray to use a specific agency outside of Pennsylvania with our own estimated numbers to act as if that's concrete. And I never worked that way in my past. It's difficult for me to work that way now. And I know some things can't be pinpointed. But I think as the members brought up today with respect to some of the things in the past and some of the things that are gray, it's tough to sort of jump on that data as something that's not concrete or more concrete. So that's my last comment. Appreciate it, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Rep. Cerisi.
I have a follow-up, but on some of the comments that were just made, I think that maybe we should look at this also from an educational standpoint with our vocational schools, if there's something that we can teach within the parameters of the vocational school when it comes to this. But being in the Southeast, and you would know this, you just said you were from Montgomery County, and I'm glad to hear that. We have Valley Forge in Chester County. Well, both counties really to expand into. It's constantly deer that have been hit by cars on 422, and a few years ago they thinned the herd at Valley Forge. But to the sportsman side of it, it was very controversial because it was sharpshooters who came in. Now, I know that's federal land, but is there a way we can begin to work with the federal government on this? Because I never understood why we couldn't bring hunters in. I mean, even through a lottery or you got to go through a training, that was a great way to do it. And those deer at Valley Forge, I mean, if you want to be protected, live at Valley Forge as a deer. No one's coming after you other than the cars on 422 and the other highways. It becomes a major hazard to those neighborhoods and the area around Valley Forge and the damage that's done and the other predators who are in that park or no predators in that park. So how are we working with the federal government? I don't know what other areas we would have throughout the Commonwealth that is that big as Valley Forge, where we may have the same type of issue.
Dr. Schnoop, do you have anything to add with specific to Valley Forge? Now, we work with municipalities and others on deer issues, and we leave it up to the communities on how they want to deal with it. We provide support, help them develop their own management plan for their community. But Matthew, do
you want? Yeah, no, you're fair enough statement, and basically the question about urban deer management, and it is left up to the individual landowner, in this case Valley Forge, where they viewed target removal as more of a safe, and that was done with Wildlife Services, most likely. I can't speak directly to it, but they viewed that probably as more of a safe option, or maybe what happened was that they just couldn't get hunter participation in that area, or maybe it just didn't lend itself to. We do work a lot with our Southeast region of engaging hunters, bow hunters that are hunting, you know, 100 feet from 200 feet from a house. And so we definitely support that, but there is also that issue of just, you know, urban deer management is left upon the landowner.
I have a couple hundred acres in Limerick. And now that urban sprawl has happened, you know, when we moved out there 20 years ago, there was nothing. And they would hunt in the field across the street. Now the hunter showed up and every neighbor called the police saying there's a guy with a gun in the field, you know, and didn't understand it. But with the Valley Forge issue, I'm wondering how we can engage more on the Fed side, because they're going to have to thin the herd again. There's no question. I mean, depending on how well and healthy that herd is in Valley Forge. And it was a major issue with the people in my district, and I'm sure you could speak to this too, because you're talking about it, that people are like, why can't we get some hunters in there? Why does it have to be on the sharpshooter side? So you may want to speak
to that. This isn't new, Rep. You know where I'm from. Greater Ford is another great example of, but the Game Commission has been able to come in there over the years because of who actually owns it and who manages it. That was a 500-acre piece of property that was phenomenal in farming, and they've even stopped all the farming that they used to even provide, you know, programs for the inmates to go out there and garden and farm, and a lot of that has been thwarted. But I know guys who lined that property during the 2 and 3 day hunts because they knew what was coming. Okay, they did change their techniques a lot of how they hunted it by carousing the deer herd with vehicles and pushing them. And it was a good opportunity for kids because we had kid program in there and a senior program. And so, but that was a little bit different than Valley Forge. And so Valley Forge, which used to make my mouth water when I was working on a house down there back in the day, because some of those beasts would walk past as if, you know, they were just out for a stroll. And then you would have people who put nets around all the rhododendron and all their mountain laurel and everything because they didn't want the deer to browse on them. And I believe there was a vehicle deer conflict every single day for I don't even know how many years. So it's a real problem, especially on Route 23. But welcome to Pennsylvania. That's why I say that, because there's been some dynamics that have been going on in certain places that I wanted to see something open for the sportsmen there, and the federal government was pretty tough to deal with. And then they hired, you know, different people, and I wouldn't have minded to have been one of those people. I would have even volunteered my services. You wouldn't have had to cut me a check, you know, just because there's issues. It's just like Arizona. They had one that they put, I went into that pole in Arizona for buffalo. And they have to have those areas thinned out because of how many they stay in one spot. So I think it's a good point. It's a good question you brought up. But and it may just take the Game Commission to press a little bit harder with being allowed to interact at the federal property. Good question.
Representative Mahaffey.
Thank you, sorry. Thank you, Madam Chair. Brian, you mentioned about polling, and how often do you guys poll?
Well, we don't. I don't call them polling, because the polling that you all would be familiar with, especially the political side, is much different. We do surveys, so there's
sure.
a difference between the two. But we do surveys. We do our game take survey every year. We do our deer survey every several years. So we're constantly doing surveys. Constantly.
Okay. On the issue of Monday start, Saturday start, you mentioned some numbers.
Yeah.
In that, I guess what I'm getting after is we talked about it several years ago. It was a 3-year look back and then to see where things are at. Do you see that happening again to justify that start on Saturday rather than Monday?
I think, you know, the agency will continue to evaluate and use the appropriate methodology to survey hunters. Up with that, what the hunters are thinking. Again, getting that data, asking the hunters, or whether I'm measuring deer or I'm asking data and the information, help guide our decision making.
Okay, thank you for that. The second part is the tour at the Elk. I was able to go on that this year also, or actually it was last year, and this goes back to Rep Banta when he said about how do you do things and promote things, and what can you do to promote it with children. I didn't realize what a great piece of property you guys have up there, or the foundation and who's all involved in that in Benazet. And I know that's under Rep. Arminetti's area. And when I was leaving, he goes, be careful of the elk running across the road. You know, we worry about deer running across the road up there. It's about elk. And I think they do a little bit more damage to vehicles than a deer. But getting back to that, I mean, you pull into that parking lot, and you listen to the bugling, and I know Rep. Labs was with me on the tour. It's incredible. I mean, and then you go up there and see all the bulls and the cows, and you really are close. You take the tour. After that, I encouraged so many people, whether it be Boy Scout groups or church groups or whoever, make the trip. Plan a trip. Plan a day. It's something spectacular.
Oh, it's phenomenal. There's so much. It's just amazing.
So when you guys do and take in the money for the lottery for the elk, does that go toward that and benefit what you have up there, or how does that work?
It goes to support our research and our habitat management for elk in the elk range. As you can imagine, elk take a very specialized habitat. They are grazers. So it takes a lot of financial investments by the agency to make sure we have the appropriate habitat for the elk. And that's how you really determine where the elk are going to be. There are certain places like south of 80 we don't want them because of conflict with agriculture. So we use habitat development as a way. You know, elk are going to go where the habitat's good.
When you showed us that, and we were out and viewed the fields that you guys were working on, do you earmark that money specifically for elk, or is that just part of the general fund?
Well, it's part of our overall budget, but, you know, those funds, you know, when you look at it, it's kind of like if you have 10 jobs, you know, all that money comes in. You don't look at it, the dollar from this job was paid for this. You know, the funding comes in, and Dan, he may have an overview of what habitat management activities and costs go for the elk range, but it's pretty substantial.
In the viewing time is usually when they're in the rut season and they're bugling and so forth. And that's what, that's September season till October. And it was packed. The place was packed. It was lined up. It was just really a great view of what's going on. If you're a young person and don't understand hunting, go there and you'll want to be a hunter. Because
it
is. It truly is. So I'll leave you with this. The CWD and going off of Rep Labs and what she was saying about deer, have you guys identified, and I think I asked this question last year, have you identified or had any elk that have had CWD or any problems with that disease?
No, and we test every elk that's harvested that comes through there. So, you know, we have the response plan in place for the white-tailed deer, but it's right there, right there.
Okay, and that's being monitored, I'm assuming,
yes,
all the time, right?
Yes.
Well, great picture in there. I saw another state record. In the archery for the elk harvest on the bull.
Yep.
That's pretty incredible. Again, keep up the good work. We really appreciate it, and look forward to working with you in this up-and-coming session.
Thank you.
And our last question will be from Representative Haddock.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just as a follow-up to the vendor license and the selling, and I do believe, and I know they're now combined. I believe they're combined you could sell the fishing license and the hunting license out of the same unit, or are they two different units?
You can buy your fishing license at the same place you buy your hunting license.
Okay. And the vendor, as a side note, is out of state. The vendor is not a Pennsylvania company, though, correct?
No, we can only go with who bids on the project. So,
I understand.
And I'm not sure, and I see where they're from. You do a lot of contracts, I believe, in Pennsylvania.
That's okay. They're out of state. My son-in-law, my stepson just bought an odd license, and.
You're okay. I know where your confusion's coming from. That's the fulfillment company.
Okay.
So the NIC is the company that actually develops the software, but yeah, they have a fulfillment company that happens to be, subcontractor.
Okay. But in keeping with the Saturday and some of the discourse of moving the opening day back and forth, so how heavy is it for a lift for a small mom-and-pop shop to get a license machine and become an approved vendor? What is the criteria? Because some of the cries are, of course, we hurt small businesses, especially in our rural areas. Can they readily get a machine that easy? Is there sales? Years ago, I heard that there was a sales quota, and of course, an initial expense, possibly bonding. Can you explain that on how a mom and pop shop would become a vendor of selling licenses for the state of Pennsylvania for us quickly? Thank
you. I'll have Dan come up. Dan, you want to provide that detail?
Yes. So there's actually a contract that we send. We put in a request to be a vendor for us, an agent, and we go ahead and they fill out the information, give us their banking information. We do a review through an approval process. And then once that's finalized, then we work with the vendor to have them send an actual system to them, printer, and give them access to our admin function, our consoles and stuff, so that they can provide licenses to individuals.
And what would be the investment from the business? Is there an upfront fee? Is there a bonding requirement?
There is bonding. I can get you the actual amount then. I don't recall it right offhand, but there is a bond that they have to have setting with us in case there's any issues moving forward.
I understand that. But again, is it something that, and it could be a loss leader for business to get business in. Not everything you have in a retail store makes money. But again, how lucrative or unattractive the other way does it go to get a machine to be a vendor for the hunting and fishing license in the state of Pennsylvania for our businesses?
Well, it really depends on how much how many individuals come through their doors. I mean, in certain areas, they could be the only agent within a certain mile radius, which can draw more individuals to that agent to provide them licenses. They make a dollar off of every actual license sold, so they can make multiple. So if it's their general hunting license, and then they get a bear license, and then they get a pheasant permit, they would make like $3 off of that.
If you could, I'd like to see an outline of that kind of fee structure.
Yes,
I'd appreciate it. I think that might be interesting for the rest of the members, though I don't want to speak for us, but thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, we're coming close to our time, but I will ask Chair Maloney if he has any final comments.
Oh, thank you, Chairwoman. In light of the last rep, he's brought this up twice. Brian, can you just answer quickly, or maybe the other gentleman, with respect to any dry runs or tests been done on the new license proposal purchase?
Yeah. I'll have Deanna Vance come up.
Have you done any dry runs on it? Because you said you expect glitches, which is sort of normal, which is why I had questions from the very beginning. But have you done any testing or dry runs?
We are working very closely with the vendor right now. They're in the middle of doing several performance and load tests to identify what the volume is of how many transactions can go through the system on a per hour basis without causing negative effects on the system. So we're still doing those things. But like Brian said, we do expect there to be some slow down as it relates to the amount of volume. We just really don't know what the buying habits are going to be. A lot of the communications that we will be sending out to hunters, we don't really want to direct them what to do, but we want to try to tell them that not everybody has to try to hit the system at 8 o'clock the first morning of sales.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So, and I think one of the other questions was about, you know, how are we preparing our vendors? We've got a pretty strong communication plan work and training plan working with the vendors too on what they can expect and just getting them some additional materials for them to use to try to help them with the crowds and try to help them with providing additional information to hunters around antlerless license sales, you know, when they have the lines in their stores like that.
But
so,
there won't be a fallback of any kind to go back to the cursed pink envelope type procedure. So in other words, if this doesn't work for a week or it crashes, there won't be a way to mail in or go in person the same way with the pink envelope. In person, I guess you'd have to still go by the electronics, correct?
Yeah, you still have to go on.
It's
it's
same system, yeah, whether the county treasurer performs sale from an application.
But it wouldn't be a hard copy version of doing it. Would just be wait till the system comes back up to get it?
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Our vendor's very well engaged in this process. I mean, we're working very hand in hand with them to make sure that it can go as smoothly as it. And this year's going to be a learning curve. That's just how it's going to roll. And each year it will improve. So we're doing
it. And I think we've got to remember that the county treasurer is still going online. That's how the license is ordered. It's just a timing thing.
Yeah, my concern is the sportsman not being able to process through it, especially those that are not computer savvy. So I guess my last sort of comment question, Brian, would be last year when I asked you about especially seeing the revenue spike, which some of us anticipated with the natural gas, I know that jumping in onto the Reggie was something that you said you weren't sure how or why it happened, and I don't know if there's anybody here that could get me that answer, but I was always concerned with why somebody voted that you didn't want to vote that way.
Well, it was a miscommunication, as I mentioned before. One of the staff, we talked, and for some reason it didn't flow through. That's all I could say.
Well, and again, I guess, as I said before, my concern would be that we saw this coming, and now we have all the revenue, which would be something that would be counterproductive to me with respect to how we got that revenue to sportsmen. So thanks again. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Appreciate everyone being here. As you can tell, we have a very involved committee. The members have a vested interest, all of us do, in what goes on in our districts as far as hunting and the Game Commission, and we appreciate you coming here today. At this point, I'm going to adjourn this meeting, and I would remind our members that we're reconvening at 1 o'clock with the Fish and Boat Commission. Thank you.